pronounce it?
Mi'kmaq.
Thank you, Anne, and thank you for to everybody for coming out. It's an honor to be here this evening, and I'm staying now.
Lunch, breakfast, dates, everything's open as long as you're paying. I'm good. I'm happy to hang out. Yeah, it is an honor to be welcomed here in the territory with the drum and Chiki. Thank you very much. It's nice to see you again. And you know, this work that is happening now under the guise of reconciliation is important work. And on the way over here, Anne and I were talking about that work, and it's we called it like a bag of puppies that just showed up at your door. And you're like, oh shit, look here. It's a bag of puppies. But the puppies are a reconciliation, and you can't drown them. You know, you can't. You've never drowned a puppy? Really? No. Ooh, like 30 seconds in, people's buttholes are just like, I don't know if I like it. I don't know. I'm not. He didn't even say hi yet. Like, why? Just how rude. It is rude. I should tell you who I am. In my language, my grandmother always said, use your language when you go there. So, Gana Mushum, Wa Makwa Indigenous Kaz, Makwa Ndo Dem, Kuchiching Ndonje. What I've just said in my language is, this is a stick up, pass your wallets to the front. that's... White men carry wallets, so that's why I'm after white men. President liked that joke. He's right here. He's really laughing. I want your wallet. In my language, I've introduced myself by my name, which was given to me through ceremony, and I do that in a way to let you know how I position myself. So my name is Ryan McMahon. I'm Anishinaabe from Treaty 3 in northwestern Ontario, and I'm Bear Clan. And so my original instructions, the instructions that are given to me by name and by clan, are set out before me. And this is part of the work that I do to kind of fulfill those clan requirements that were given to me, you know, through ceremony. So it's and that's not funny. That's just that's the truth. So it's nice to be here to try to share some reflections and some thoughts. On reconciliation, hopefully we laugh a little bit, and hopefully white people cry, and then we get the land back, and then we all live happily ever after, because it's all about land. It is. It really is like if we can't program and service our way out of this mess, right? Because, you know, Trudeau, I don't know, it's not going so well so far. Lots of promise, good hair on the guy. But did anyone else want to throat punch him every time he grabs an Indigenous elder by the shoulders and gives it this one? Like, one more time, JT. And if I'm in the crowd, I'm just going to scream, throat punch! And that elder is just, it's in our DNA. It'll come slowly, but it will, boosh. We're in a time that we didn't know was going to happen. That this is the bag of puppies. This is, and we were like, it's on us to commit to being better in our life. And not, for some, not being mean to brown people. That's what reconciliation is for some. For others, it's about the redistribution of power. For others, it's about relearning or unlearning this myth that we've been sold, that this country is this great place. And there's two things I want to say on the eve of this big birthday party. Boy, they didn't waste any time, eh? New Year's Eve, midnight, dong, dong, and it was like, put the fireworks up, we're the best! And then it just started, and the propaganda rolled, and I'm here to say that we certainly have work to do. We have a lot of work to do in this country, and this is why we're here. So I'm preaching to the choir a little bit, though some of you are not just judging by your body language, not convinced. This tells me this is like the silent F word. Like, pretty much says everything I need to know. So we have work to do, and this is something we didn't know was going to happen. And maybe most concerning for me is, I have kids. I have two little girls. So now this is their lifelong project, and this is your grandchildren's lifelong project. It is our work that we have to take up to reconcile, right? And I don't even, what does that mean? What does it mean? Because this is a real time, each and every day. No plan, no handbook, no website, no YouTube videos, no apps. It's face-to-face conversations about making this place better. And so we shouldn't be afraid to make mistakes, because we're going to make mistakes. We're going to fumble our way through it, but we're going to do it. And, you know, our children are the ones that are going to have to do this work. So the more we engage now, the lighter the load is for them. So I encourage you all to think of it that way. We have big shoulders, right? We can do this together. And the challenges of doing this work become the ways our children can benefit. So that's the way I try to frame the conversation. My kids, they're in the van, so I do have to make this quick tonight because people get mad at that joke. Like when I, like, they're not in a van, they're in a car, but they're not, and they're not here. They're at the Winnipeg airport waiting for me to come. We're playing hide and go seek and they're losing. Like, where'd he go? New Brunswick. People get mad at that joke. Like in Saskatoon, I told that joke after I wrote it and I thought it was pretty funny. I was like, oh, this will get me into this material. And boy, I got in trouble. You know, there was a 90-year-old Cree woman that after the show, she was chasing me down in the parking lot. I heard just from behind me, hey, come here, fat boy. And I was like, Dad, you know, what? And I looked around and it was this elderly woman. She's wearing, you know how our old people dress all their clothes on at once, you know, like four or five skirts. Why don't they have dresser drawers? Like that's what you could buy your granny for Christmas. She had a walker and she was coming at me. Get over here, fat boy, I want to talk to you. And I couldn't figure out what the hell I had said in the show to make her mad. And that's not my intention. My intention tonight is, everyone, I want you to leave happy. I don't want anyone mad. That's my job, to make you happy. And I thought, maybe I screwed up. Maybe she was mad. So I approached her kind of thinking, man, I really hope she's not mad. And she says, let me tell you something, fat boy. I have the Facebook too. And how about I go on Facebook and tell everyone on Facebook that you think child abuse is funny? I don't think child abuse is terrible. What do you mean? She said, oh, locking your kids in a car. She didn't realize it was a joke. But I also wanted to kind of stand up for myself, because that's bullshit. I don't think that's funny at all, you know. But also, it kind of, back in the day, like my people over here, like that's like a rite of passage on some level, right? Like that's how some of us earned our first eagle feather, right? You survived just a few hours outside a casino. You know what I'm saying? Just mom just wants to go play 20 bucks and try her luck. You know, like, we don't have rent money. I'm going in. Like, you stay here. So I told her that. I said, I'm a survivor, lady. Okay, I can talk about this. For me, that's the revolution, is our families. That's, I don't care what color underwear the prime minister wears, whether it's orange or blue or red. Well, red, we don't need them back. But, we don't need the blue back either. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who our national chief is. It's for me, the revolution 100% is our families, right? It's our children. It's that next generation. This is the way I think, is that our children are at the center of our communities. They always were, they always should be. And this is why residential school was so devastating, was because it directly targeted children. in what can only be framed as the most cowardly act imaginable. Yeah. It directly targeted children and therefore families and communities. Justice Murray Sinclair says, imagine a community with no children in it. You know? So for me, the revolution is our children. How do we do it right? We don't get a do-over. Are there parents in the room? You know this, right? Like, we got one shot, and it's like, it's hard, man. Oh my God, it's like, talk through your teeth hard, you know? Like, just like, Dad, like some days, it's like, Dad has to go for a walk, you know? Like, just hard. And it should be that hard. You should have felt that. If you cared about your children, you'd feel that emotion all the time. Because that would mean you're there, you're trying, and you just don't have the answers. Sometimes when I talk through my teeth, my kids are like, Dad, you're spitting. And I'm like, it's hilarious. But for me, that's that is the revolution, is the children, is the future that I'm looking forward to. And I call it the 2167, 150 years from now, when Canada turns 300. That's what I'm envisioning, the 2167. And I envision this freedom that we haven't experienced for hundreds of years, and a set of diverse and vibrant communities and families and nations that are able to live here, love here, play here, and be here in our own homelands. So how do we get there? I'm gonna make some propositions. We'll see what we think. We have to get off the internet, because we're just like I like the internet. The internet's here. Like, hi, live stream. shut it off. It's about to get real. No. we can't just go back. Because that's like in small town Canada, that's the response that I get. Well, why don't you go back to living in the bush? Fuck, I'd love to. Sure. Sure. No problem, right? What, you don't want to go, you got to be, it's towards 2017. Yeah, it is. So there's challenges to this idea, but just come with me, if you will. I think like we're on the internet too much. I think like Facebook is the new diabetes. Can we agree? Like, it's, I call it the new diabetes. Like, diabetes has done a number on our people. Now it's Facebook. Like, we're just addicted. Some of you are on it right now. Like, so you don't think I can see you, but either your private parts are on fire and there's a light. Like, put it out. Put the fire out. It's lighting your face. Or your phone is on and you're on Facebook. Chicky. I think your crotch is on fire. Someone throw some water on it. No. We're addicted to Facebook, and I like it's insane. It's like, it's actually kind of crazy. We wake up at 7 in the morning, right? And the first thing we do, we don't look around the house to see if someone broke in. We don't check to see if everyone's still alive. No. It's like, where's mommy's iPhone? Where is it? Where's what? Don't judge me. Okay, I need to see if Brenda broke up with Dave last night. Okay, we're addicted to the internet, and everything's on it. Everything's always on it. Everything's always on the internet. The constant status updates. Oh, Brenda did break up with Dave last night. LOL, like, hey, like, just everything's always on the internet. You have a waterproof case on your phone so you can have your morning pee. Girlfriend, we're going for Indian tacos at lunch. I told you he was no good. Call his brother, hey, you know, just like, we're just like. So then that day when Brenda has broken up with Dave, it's just a constant stream of, I'm at work and I'm better off without him. And it's good, my kids are going to be fine. And then it's like, no, they're not. I hate him. And then it's just constant. It's just, everything's on there. Always. And it's not the status updates that bother me so much, though I had a cousin lose his summer job because he put a status update on there after work one day. Like, he's got a degree, went to school, ended up working for a band, and it was like powwow time. So it's like all hands on deck. Like, you go mow the grass over here and go clean the ditch, you know, like you guys have ditch cleaning days on your res? Yeah, right? Like, get the garbage out of the ditch. Everyone's coming. So everyone's helping out on the res. And he was asked to do that. And so he did it for one day and he got off work and he updates his status. He's like, I hope, capitals, I hope Bob, the boss, asks me to cut grass tomorrow. I swear to God, if he asks me, I'm gonna walk out the door. Hits publish. First person to like the status, Bob, right? Oh, see you later, asshole. That's easy for me then. Bye-bye, right? So the status, like the internet can get you in trouble, is what I'm saying. And what bothers me most are the pictures. Just the selfies. Selfie. Oh my God, selfie. Selfie at selfie sticks. Self, really? Like, our ancestors died for us to have selfie sticks. Selfie. I just want a selfie. The constant, just express, like, just the, like, the, just the, just, like, the pursed up little, the, like, the, just the, like, and we're going to talk about the guys and the girls. I'm not a misogynist. I don't got a problem with women. So we'll talk about both here. But ladies, like, that, the duck lips. What is this? You think it looks sexy. Just the thin little windburnt Mi'kmaq lips. You think it looks sexy, but you look drunk and tired, okay? Unless you're Duck Clan, knock it off. Yeah? Like, unless... And then even worse, pushing these little things to get me... Just in that dirty res mirror. Oh. 700 friends on Facebook. You couldn't find one to take your picture. So you're just in that mirror. Now, guys, you're not off the hook either, because you do this. When your girlfriend's done, you're like, get out of here, my turn. You're posed out in the same mirror with your sleeveless cutoff t-shirt, right? Like Halifax powwow singing champion 2002 t-shirt, spaghetti stains. Cut the sleeves off, you're all flexed out. Yeah! Showing off your seasonal employment tan. Yeah! Showing off that homemade dream catcher eagle feather combo tattoo. Yeah! With your name through the middle, Steve. Yeah! In case I forget my name. Yeah! Came out of a show in Edmonton, a guy named Steve wanted to show me his very unfortunate tattoo after the show. You, bro. People do get mad, and some people are having a good time, some aren't here. It's just numbers. I'm trying. But some people do get mad, you know, after shows, and mostly people get confused about the way I look, because I have fair skin, right? Essentially, I'm white-coated, I'm white-passing. Ever stuck in an elevator at a hotel during a KKK convention, I'm gonna walk out of there, right? Like, this is, that's a dark joke to laugh at, but that's the truth. So people get confused when they see me, a native comedian, and then everyone's expecting Adam Beach, and then fucking I show up, right? People wanna fight me after shows because of the way I look, which I think is so silly. You want to fight me about the way I look? Go fight my mom, okay? She's the one that hooked up with a white guy that couldn't afford a condom. So if you want to fight anyone about this, and good luck, she's an old school native woman, okay? Residential school survivor. Survivor. She's old school, man. She can fillet fish with her fingernails, kind of old school. Sit down and eat, you know? Old school, man. She can fillet fish with her fingernails, skin beaver with her teeth. Ah. It's confusing as a kid because people say the same thing. You're lucky, man. You're lucky. You've never experienced racism in Canada, bro. So stop complaining about your fair skin. You've never been racially profiled, bro. You don't get pulled over by the cops, bro. You don't get pulled over for your braids and cheekbones, bro. That's true, but I wish I did. Stop complaining about your fair skin, bro. You've never experienced racism, so knock it off. And to that, I just say, okay? I've experienced my fair share of racism. Let's just say it's not fun for me at the powwow, okay? In my regalia, okay? Sitting at my drum having 400-pound powwow singers walk by me all weekend, kicking at my chair, goddamn hippie. Go home. You know, and it was confusing at my... Like, as a kid at my grandmother's dinner table, sitting around, everybody's brown, 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 brown. Then me, just a gross shade of pink, you know, just hot dog pink. You know what I'm saying? The grossest shade of pink. Bunch of fair-skinned people not laughing. Like, you know, fuck you, man. I came here to have a good time. I didn't even really know, like, I come from a long line of residential school survivors, right? I wasn't raised with my language or my culture, and I had to discover all of that later in life, ironically at a university, and I went to my first sweat in Toronto, and I crawled out of the sweat downtown Toronto at Anishinaabe Health, crawled out, just crying ugly too, like afraid of the dark crying. It's so hot. But I crawled out of that sweat lodge and I was like, I transformed, I had changed, I was 21, I really challenged myself in the sweat, and I came out and I looked in the sky and there's a CN Tower, just the biggest Eagle staff I've ever seen, just, Migo Edge creator. Didn't know what it meant to be native until I went to my first Indian protest. I call it Indian protest because, man, we were Indian protesting. Huh? We love, some of you right now are like, where? Like, we're down. We're down. Just the word, just it wakes up your spirit, right? It's like, let's go. This guy rips off his shirt, camo. Yeah. I wear camo underwear just in case. Like, I'm ready. But it was that first... That was a late laugh, but I'll take it. That's fine. That's good. That very first protest I went to, I don't know what we were mad about, but right? Like, sometimes when that phone rings, you just go. It's Tuesday. It's 10 in the morning. Your cousin calls. Hey, what's going on? Nothing, bro. Come on down to the band office. Oh, what for? I don't even know, but there's a protest. Let's go. I don't know, man. Shit, I don't. Come on, man. There's a free barbecue after. Let's go. So you're like, well, fuck, I like hot dogs, so I'm... Jump in your truck, drive. You're getting your Metallica. Metallica's on the... You put in that... That's one for the older native people. The Metallica's on the radio. You get down to the protests, there's just six chubby Indians just kind of like, I don't know, fuck, I just came for the barbecue. I don't even know, like. And that one guy that calls all the protests, he comes out and they're like, well, what are we here for? What are we even here for, man? Like, what are we protesting? I don't know, but look mad when CBC comes, okay? Just look pissed off when they show up. So I don't. I'm not perfect. I don't remember what we were mad about, but we were at Ontario's provincial legislative buildings. We were at Queen's Park, and it's about 600 people. Everyone's milling about, you know, kind of. And I was trying to get a sense of what. I was there to meet a girl. She was a tattoosist from Saskatchewan, so I was like, I'm in, and I went. Protest love, man. It's we make babies sometimes. Anyway. I don't know how many I don't know more babies, right? Quite a few. Remember that? We were mad, man, for like 3 weeks. We were mad. Dead middle of winter, minus 40. I don't know more. It's like, fuck, you better idle a little bit. You're going to get frostbite. Go idle a little bit. Shit, you look cold, brother. Go. But I was there because I even before the protest, I went to the bay, to the cologne tester aisle, and just gave myself a little in case I saw her at the protest. I went down there, and I remember the moment where my spirit just it came alive in a way that I'd never experienced before, and like 600 people just milling about, and then you could see the politicians up in the building. They're kind of looking down, and they look scared, and they're not sure what's going on, and then that chant started. Screw the white man. Now, I know it's not good to say white man. Like, who hates the words white man more than white men, right? White men hear the term white man, and they want to, what, don't, that's racist, you can't, don't call, you're going to identify me by that, really? Lack of character, well, are you a white man? Yeah. Then just be white, man, just be cool. Don't be Donald Trump white, but just be white. He's orange. Oh, touche, he is indeed. But I was never politicized up until that point. And I'd never heard anyone say anything like this before. And the chant was real quiet at first, screw the white man. And it woke up this, the elders would call it like a spirit fire. It's your spirit, it's our spirits, it's in you, right? It's inherent, it's what we're born with, was this spiritual fire. That's what our lives are. It's our spirits cross and we connect and I'd never really understood this until that chant. And it started to pick up steam, and as the chant started to pick up steam, that spirit fire, you know, it started to grow. And I was feeling this pride that I didn't understand, and I didn't know like what I was feeling, but I wanted to scream, I wanted to sing, I wanted to dance. It felt so amazing, but I was still shy. And so the chant, as it picked up, screw the white man, I was wanting to get in there, but I didn't understand it. And it was like a bad ventriloquist act, you know, screw the white man, screw the white man, screw the white man, screw the white man, screw the white man. And I couldn't understand that moment. And as the chant grew louder, the spirit fire grew bigger, and then it just came out. And everyone's just screaming, you know, screw the white man! And then I'm screaming, screw the white man! And I'm dancing, and I've got a screw the white man thing going, and I'm screaming, screw the white man! And I get carried away with it, and I look around. I don't know how long I've been dancing and chanting and... But I look around and no one's screaming it anymore. What's going on, guys? Let's go. Let's screw. Look, he's there. There. Look, screw the white man, you guys. Let's do it. Let's screw the white man. And then it dawned on me. There's 600 brown faces staring at me thinking I'm propositioning sex, you know? Screw the white man. Screw the white man. Screw. 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 Screw the white man. Screw him. But we live in a different time now. Our young people are talking about decolonization. Our young people are demanding more from chiefs and councils. Our young people are the fastest growing population in this country. Our young people, more and more, are enrolling in post-secondary education. We have more doctors, lawyers. It's happening. And I think our ancestors dreamed about this time. This is what they were dreaming about. This is what they had hoped for. And we're in this moment, and it's this massive transition. And no one should feel challenged or overwhelmed by this, because we're told by our elders that the Creator doesn't give you more than you can handle, that you are given what you need. And I love that idea, that right now we are in this beautiful, powerful, transitional time where nothing should be off the table, right? Like, we should have the most honest conversations we can have. And I've been quoted recently in the media about me bailing out of Canada 150 events and all this, and it's kind of being skewed into something that I don't mean. I'm in, man. My daughters are growing up. I want them to be safe in this country, yeah? There's an inquiry going on right now in this country, and I have two Indigenous daughters, okay? So I'm in. I'm in with both feet, my heart, my mind. I'm doing all the work I can to bring the best version of myself to the table, okay? I'm not getting in shape, but like my heart, my mind is like fuck you. I saw Chicky, he looked twice like that. He's like, God damn. What is this? I didn't have that before. Like, if you Google sad, just for fun, Google sad Anishinaabe man, and the first Google image search result is my breast. It's just. I reached a new level of fat recently where if I drop something, I need to decide if I need that thing or not, okay? Oh, shit. Look, come on, you son of a, come on now. Shit. Keep spare keys in the cupboard, that kind of fat, you know? The level of fat where you sweat when you vacuum. Anyone else? Chubby people on their phones. You know, I don't know. I'm not a huge fan. I'm not sure. He's pretty good. He's not as good as Don Bernstick, but still pretty good. You know, I just fucking assholes. You. Yeah, we're in this. We're in this time, and I am doing work on myself. Like, I got work to do, okay? You've seen me do stand-up and write things publicly and say shit on Twitter. My Twitter is a mess. Last night I was going in on the right. Here's a funny tweet from last night. I think it's funny. Anyone ever tell the right in Canada that they're wrong? Hashtag dad jokes. Dad jokes. It's hard. It's because this project is massive, and it's in real time. It's the decisions we make every day. It's in my language we call it the journey towards Mino Bamadzuin, and Mino Bamadzuin in my language, what we talk about is this journey of a good long life, the good life. And I don't know if you ever get there. Like, I don't know if Mino Bamadzuin is even possible, but it's the journey towards that good life that makes it worth it. And I'm all in. And I made a list of resolutions for this year, you know, lies. You know, it's like, oh, this is it. Yeah, no more, deep fried food at the powwow. No, yeah, I'm gonna. But I had a near-death experience before Christmas that really hit a reset button for me. I was on a plane going to from Edmonton to Yellowknife, and we lost power. Just lost engine, no engines. And it was just quiet. And the captain comes on the air, on the intercom. He says, "Hey, good afternoon," in that fucking voice, that voice. "Hey, good afternoon, lady." Like a failed radio DJ went out and got his pilot license. "Hey, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's Wacky Tom here on the drive up to Yellowknife. There's no traffic." See what I did there? Clear skies. But he comes on and he lets us know. He goes, "Ladies and gentlemen, we just need to let you know, we are experiencing catastrophic engine failure." Oh shit, that was casual. Like, just wanna let, oh, by the way, there's only a few words that you can't say on planes. Bomb, don't say that word. That's a bad word on planes. Oops, I farted, another one. Not good to say on it. And catastrophic engine failure. That's on the list too. Captain Anderson. Then he says, "Don't panic." Well, holy shit. No one was panicking until you said, "Don't panic." Woman grabs a headrest, starts ripping it out of the fucking bolts on the counter. He says, "We're going to let you know what's going to happen." "Oh, are you? Are you? That's nice of you. Thanks, good old boy from Saskatchewan. We're going to let you know what's going on. Sit back, relax." So I'm sitting there and I'm like, what? Like, there is not, even like, there's not a sound. Usually the wind, the air, you can always count on a crying baby, right? Even the baby's like, oh shit. And they're like, what do you do? And I sat there and I was thinking, like, this can't be. Like, this isn't the way it ends. Like, what the hell, right? And the woman who's grabbing the headrest, she says, "Somebody say something." And I'm a helper. In my language, we call it oshkabewis, those who help. And I just want to help in the situation. And I'm like, somebody should say something. And then she says, "Somebody say a prayer." And I'm a pretty hardcore Anishinaabe nationalist, right? Like, I want my land back. What is that? By the way, we used to be out here a couple of hundred years ago. This is Anishinaabe territory. We'll be coming back for that shit later, but just kidding. But I'm on the plane kind of not sure what to do. And as soon as she said, "Say somebody pray," I was like, "I'll do it." And it just came out. And this was confusing because it came out, "Our Father who art in heaven." I've never been to church. I've never been to church. "Our Father," in this one, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." People turn around. "There's a priest on the plane." I start doing this shit to people. Aho, 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 aho. "Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not..." It's intense. I knew the... How do I know the prayer? I get done the prayer, and I'm like, I kind of snap out. I'm like, holy shit, that was cool. That was pretty cool. She says, "Keep going!" "Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you, and you, and you, and you, and you." And the captain comes back on the intercom, interrupts my prayer, which was rude, but I was, you know, I'll forgive him. And he says, we got to let you know, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to descend. He's lying. We're free falling. We're not descending. Descending implies that he's flying the goddamn plane, okay? We're going to descend down to 18,000 feet, at which time we're going to throw on our emergency power, sit back, relax, and thanks for flying Air Canada. And we descend. We just slowly fall. Slowly. Takes about 3 minutes. And in that 3 minutes, I'm like, I'm saying goodbye to my daughters. I'm like, you know, saying goodbye to my parents and like, thank you for everything. And I thought of all the delicious butter chicken I'll never eat again. I thought of it. I was like, oh, just, you know when you get the leavings in your fingernail, just late at night, you're like, what does that smell? You smell it and you're like, oh, goddamn, that's a little butter chicken. And it's like, I'll never have that again. Holy shit, that was a good... It was an early dinner. Fuck, why did I let Chicky take home the leftovers? I should have... I'm going to Facebook Chicky, see if he's... Chicky, wake up. Wake up, I'm coming for the curry. Get up. Get up, you son of a... Get up. But I was thinking of all the things I'll never have, and then it happens. The turbulence comes, and things start kind of falling, and then there's this moment where we're flying again. You feel it. We're flying, and we circle around, and he says, "Ladies and gentlemen, make sure your seatbelts are on." Okay, that's going to be helpful when we crash. We're going to be landing in the Edmonton area in a few minutes. Yeah, just around Edmonton somewhere, just in the area. Maybe West Edmonton Mall, the Musquechese, just somewhere around Edmonton. Sit back and relax. And we did, and we landed, and he says, this is a standard landing, which was bullshit too, because there were 50 emergency vehicles. And we land, we skid off the runway a little bit, and we're safe. And as soon as the plane stops, people look at me and they go, thank you, Father. I had forgotten I had done all that shit. I'm working two weddings this summer. Like it's a new side gig. But it was sobering because that moment, and we all lived. No one was hurt. There was no trouble. And for whatever reason, I feel truly that I have this new chance, this other chance, and so I got to do the work. I got to get better. The new version of me, whatever that is. And so, the turn of the year, I made a list of things I want to work on, and the number one thing is patience. Because I'm not a patient, like in public, I'm patient in my own life, like I don't want or need anything, but when I see things in public, it's really hard, like injustices or something going on, it's hard for me not to interject or to get in there to say, I'm not going to do that anymore. Because I've done it, and it's got me in trouble. It's got me in trouble. Again, on a plane, we were delayed, and little Billy, that's his name, he was about 7, native, little white boy. It's okay. Don't get mad about the white. He was white. He was running around during a delay. And there's a thunderstorm, so we couldn't get off the plane. We couldn't. We had to sit there. And the delay turned, 15 minutes to half an hour to 45 minutes, and it was uncomfortable for me because I'm a big guy and I'm squished in the seat. And the woman beside me got there before I did, so she was bigger than me, which isn't important, but just to say she was like really in the seat, like really. And then all I could do would be like to put my arm on her shoulder, just uncomfortably. Yeah. You got the land and the armrest, huh? Yeah, it's okay, it's fine. No, my tingling fingers, it's probably just the diabetes. It's good. So the delay kept getting longer and longer. And the captain has the audacity to come on and say, hey, we want to invite you to get up and stretch your legs. It's going to be another 15 minutes, we're told. Get up, stretch your legs, explore the cabin of the airplane a little bit, talk to your neighbor, get to know someone new. Go to the bathroom one last time. We're going to get you up and on your way. Thanks for flying with Air Canada. And that's a party I'm not invited to get up and explore the cabin of a plane. Because the aisles are not, look at this, can you see me? I can't, like I'd walk sideways down the aisle, so I can't just explore, like I can't have the party that other people are invited to have. And people do, you change the rules on a plane, people lose their mind. Because as soon as the announcement came, people started getting up and looking at each other, like, we're gonna, let's explore. So I'm watching people kind of do this, and I can't do it. The aisle would have to be empty, and I'd go sideways, and my bum would be in your seat. Like it would be, I'm sorry, and then my crotch is in this. I'm just exploring the cabin of the plane. And I'm basically the Columbus of, it's like, this is mine, yeah. Just exploring. Ugh. Let me explore. Nobody wants the explorer, that explorer on the plane. So I'm just sitting there, and then I see little Billy, and little Billy is he's causing problems at the front, and I can see people are upset, and then all my anger and my frustration is just fixated on Billy. I'm like, what the hell's going? Who owns that kid, right? Like, he's 6, 7, he doesn't have a visa, you know? Who's somebody's with this kid? What's going on? Because I see him grab a woman's jacket, and he puts it on like a cape, and he runs down the aisle, and then he grabs a woman's iPad, and he's doing this, it's not his iPad. And the woman's going, please, can I have it back? Don't, please, please. And nobody's saying anything. But I can see people around Billy getting mad, but nobody's saying anything. And then I draw the line when an elderly woman gets out to go to the bathroom, Billy bumps into her and she falls into her seat. And then I'm like, you know what? This is bullshit. I gotta say something. And I want to break the ice and I want to address it. Mad people, now let's be funny, right? So I wake her up. I say, hey, wake up. Hey, if that was my boy, I would have spanked him a long time ago. The exact same reaction on the plane. That's what I got. Nothing. Just a few gasps. This lady, it was like a hostage crisis. She was like, as soon as I said the word spank, she threw her hands up, oh, like that, which scared the hell out of me. So I went, oh, like that, which scared the guy in front of me. Oh. Now there's like 5 or 6 of us going like, what the hell is going on, right? And she starts talking at me through her teeth. And she tells me, oh, you want to spank him, do you? You want to spank him? I was like, no. I was joking. I'm sorry. Oh, joking. What are you, some kind of comedian? You could watch my 1-hour special on the Nope, okay, wait. It's okay. Shit. It's okay. And she continues, like no one can hear her, like through her teeth. Why, ladies, don't. People can still hear you. You son of a bitch. You know what? I can't stand you. I don't even know why I married you. You know what? To be honest, I liked your brother. I'm just being honest. You're at the grocery store. So she starts doing that to me. I want to tell you something. I'm an educator. And I've been teaching young people for 28 years. You go and you spank that young man will grow up to be a violent young man. Is that what you want? Huh? Because violence begets violence. And if you go and spank him, and I said, I'm sorry, I was joking. And that was the flight. And we sat there. She shamed me. I didn't know you couldn't spank kids. For the rest of the flight, people were talking, whispering, because I had upset people, right? one woman talks about, like, she's, you know, it's really unfair. It's just not. And I've never wanted to. Like, holy shit. Is the, like, that stereotype of the absent native father, that sometimes makes sense to me, where it's like, I quit. I can't. I used to love you. I don't even know what's happening. So I started to think, like, why did I say this? Because you can't spank kids. I heard this over and over on the plane. You can't spank kids. Kids have feelings. Fucking, apparently we didn't have feelings in the 80s, okay? Because I was spanked as a kid, all right? Straight up. By round of applause in this room, who was spanked as a kid? Just by, okay. Wow, eh? Shocker. Whoa. You know why we were spanked as kids? Because we deserved it, that's why. Because you were doing something you weren't supposed to do, and you would get it, and it would crush you. It'd be bannock slap, that's what we call it. Or sometimes quite literally with a bannock, okay? You ever been hit with a bannock, President? It is the type of spank your spirit leaves you, okay? You get hit with a freshly baked loaf of bannock, boom, and your spirit is just like, you know what, Ryan, I'm out of here. I can't do this shit anymore. And I spent the rest of that day. I did the show that night. I got to the hotel and I was bummed out. I couldn't believe I said this. I can't believe I embarrassed myself. Patience. That's why it's on the list. Got to work on it, right? And I'm laying in bed in the Best Western. In Moose Jaw, because that's how good my career's going. Playing Moose Jaw on a Tuesday at the Legion. Right before karaoke. To 9 disinterested veterans. So I'm in the Best Western, just laying there awake, thinking about what I had done. And the elders will tell you, when you need help, you go out and you offer your tobacco, make an offering. And so I grabbed my pouch of tobacco, and I went out to find a tree to put this out, to make that offering. But I'm on the prairies. There's no trees. The only tree I could find is that sad-ass cedar tree they put in a planter in front of the hotel where everyone just throws their cigarette butts. I'm in front of that tree. If you go there, that there's a pouch of tobacco just in that planter. And I was reflecting on, like, what had happened, like, what happened to my goals of being the best version of me? How can I possibly talk about reconciliation or a pathway forward if I'm angry all the time and I see these things and I make an ass out of myself? I'm no leader. I'm no person that should be saying anything. I got work to do in myself. And I was thinking like that in the Best Western that night. And then I remembered I was spanked as a kid, man. My grandmother, she was like an Anishinaabe ninja, okay? My grandma could do this thing with her moccasin. She'd just kick it up. She'd just kick it up, like, way faster than that, too. Like, just, she'd just kick it up. And, President, you ever been spanked with a moccasin? Woo! Now, my grandma, she'd kick them both up, too. And if she had them both, she'd be hopping around. Mortal Kombat! And you just... Now, in her house where I remember as a kid, she had a wood stove in the middle of one of the rooms and then a bucket of water. And I always thought the water was like, oh, something goes wrong with the fire, you pour it on. No, that's not what it's for. She'd take off that moccasin and just dip it. Just dip it. You ever been spanked with a wet moosehide moccasin? Yeah. 1986, Kuchiching First Nation. It's summertime, and it's hot, oppressively so. Hasn't rained in 6 weeks, and I'm on the res, and I'm bored with my cousin, and he says, "Hey, Ryan, let's go steal. Let's go steal, bro." And he's 4 years older than me. And I, you know, I want to impress him. I'm like, "Sure, let's go then. Let's go then." And he's like, "Let's go fuck." I'm like, "Fuck, let's go then." Now, I've never stole anything. I don't know how. I'm like, I just want to impress him. He's older than me. And he's like, "Bro, we're going to walk in. You go left, I go right. We meet in the middle." I'm like, "Okay." He's like, "What are you going to steal?" I couldn't think. My heart was, I would need to throw up. I was like, "I don't know. What are you going to steal?" He's like, "I'm going to steal that red simonins. The simonim? Simonim gum? The simonims? Simonim? That red simonim? The spice gum? Red? The simonim? Simonims? Simonims? Simonim. I'm going to steal the spice. You don't even have to brush your teeth when you eat it, bro. It's deadly. Simonins. What are you going to take?" And I was thinking fast. I was like, "I don't know." I was like, "I don't know." And then it just came. I was like, I'm going to take those blue candies. The ones Dad always has. Those blue ones. Rolaids. The little blue. The little blue candies. No, I love those. They're good. I love them. Score in. And we went. And I remember walking down that road, and I was sick and nervous, and we got to the gas bar, and then I went left, and he went right, and he got the cinnamon gum, and I got the pack of Rolaids, and we meet in the middle, and we come walking out, and we should have known we were in trouble, because his mom worked at the gas bar. So she wasn't going to call the cops on us. She was going to call our cook'em, my grandma. And that's what she did. And we should have known we were in trouble, because we got about halfway home. And even my spirit helpers, they came to warn us, huh? I'm walking down the road. He's smacking down on a cinnamon gum. I've got a full pack of Rolaids in my mouth. Just frothing at my mouth. I've never had heartburn. I don't even know what it. Frothing at, like a res dog that's been bitten by skunks, you know? Just frothy. We get around that last corner before my grandmother's house, and out of the cloud comes my spirit helper, and he lands on the road, and this big fat white bear is just staring dead into my soul, going, "Bro, bro, don't go home, bro. Bro, she knows you stole, bro." Whoosh. Thank you. Thank you, big fat white bear. And we got home. And my grandmother, she, like I say, is a residential school survivor. And we weren't raised with our language and our culture. And I wish I could tell you differently, but we weren't. And the only time my grandmother would light those medicines, the only time she would smudge, was when us kids were going to get in trouble. And she'd light one of those big old smudges, the whole smudge bowl, all the, light it up, just swearing over them, "Fucking, I'm going to kill those son of bitch kids." Kill these kids, you know. Fuck, I'm gonna get the fat one first, because he can't run, you know. So I think the time we're in, they're gonna write books about this time, you know. They're gonna write books about this time, and 40 or 50 years from now, when maybe I'm gone, maybe I'm still here. We're going to look back and say, yeah, this is what we did. we did it. And so I encourage you to look at the challenges before us in that way, in the legacy or the new legacy we get to build in this country. And we have an opportunity to do something really special. We have an opportunity to look back on this 150 years and be honest about it and decide whether or not we're going to go eat hot dogs and paint our face and listen to Sarah McLachlan. She'll probably sing, right? So anyway, we have to decide, you know, what this next 150 years will be. We have to decide what the 2167 will look like. And I encourage all non-Indigenous people to reach out and talk to somebody. Self-help. Colonialism isn't an Indigenous problem. Decolonization isn't an Indigenous project. We all must look at the effects of colonialism and how decolonization is possible within our own lives. Yeah. And that redistribution of power, the retelling of Canadian history, the unlearning of things that we've picked up through this project, smashing the patriarchy, making space for two-spirit people, keeping women in our communities safe, all of these things, this is a Canadian project, okay? And the effects can't be denied. The lingering and ongoing colonial project in this country cannot be denied because it is ongoing. Lee Miracle in Colonization Road in the film says it beautifully, that I would forgive anyone for standing on my feet if they fucking got off. Now we have 3 hours of Lee Miracle just dropping bombs, and I wish we could just release that film. But it is true that we need a political imagination in this country that has never existed before. We need the good hearts and the good minds of the people that are brave enough to have that imagination, to reimagine a country where we are all safe, where this place can be a good and just society for all of its members, not just for some. And this is the work that, unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you see it, this is the work we are burdened with. And for you young people that are in college and university now, this is for the rest of your life. Because a few years ago when I was in school, the word reconciliation wasn't used. The idea of moving past this stuff was not on the radar. I turned 40 years old this year. And when I was in university, there was no First Nations student center. There was no free photocopier. There weren't feasts. It was a very different time. So we are coming into this special time where I think I can honestly say and look at everybody in this room and tell you, I am hopeful. I believe in this country. I believe in its citizens. We have work to do. And when I say critically that you know, what we're doing right now, the status quo isn't good enough, what I'm trying to do is open a door to have the conversation about what is on the other side of that door. And be brave. The people with the strong hearts and the strong minds, we're calling you up to the front. The people that aren't there yet, we're calling you to stand beside us, to stand behind us, to watch, to listen, to ask questions, to read, to listen, to watch, to show up. Thank you so much. And before I go, I just want to sing a song to honor each and every one of you for your attendance here this evening. And I want to say, Gachimi Gwech, thank you very much to Anne and the president here and the university for hosting me and having me here this evening. It's been an honor. So, mi gwech, thank you. If there are any questions, or if we don't have time to do it in here, like Ann said, we are going to hang out. So thank you very much for coming, and we'll see you over there.
Thanks. Thank you.